Loss of force generation on repeated contraction is known as fatigue, is purely physiological phenomenon and completely reversible. However, the fatigue is purely depends on the type of activity that we engage. The type of activity depends on purely on intensity, duration and volume of exercise. And also the type of muscle fibers that they involved in the exercise process. These are the two main factors which manipulates the onset of the fatigue in the exercising muscles. So let us see the components or factors which promotes the fatigue. First is the decrease in the ATP in the cellular level, mainly in the exercising muscles. This ATP usually generated from phosphoryl creatine, handing over the one phosphate group in presence of creatinine kinase enzyme to the ADP. It converts the ATP. And however, this ATP usually consistently supplied from the oxidative phosphorylation process, which is aerobic metabolism in presence of oxygen, and or maybe glycolysis, anaerobic metabolism, absence of oxygen, or maybe fat oxidation or combination of three processes. These are the metabolic pathways which consistently feeds the ATP pool in the muscles. Further, the ATP used for the force generation in the muscles. The exhaustion of the stores, mainly glucose or glycogen or fat, triglycerides, or decreasing the oxygen supply to demanding muscles would leads to the decreasing the ATP production by decreasing the above pathways like oxidative phosphorylation, glycolysis or fat oxidation. Further, it promotes the fatigue. And secondly, the phosphoryl creatine may split into the inorganic phosphate during the forceful contraction in the muscle fibers. The phosphoryl creatine may split into the creatine plus inorganic phosphate, PI. So this inorganic phosphate, one of the key component which further affecting many pathways, mainly the calcium handling in the contractile muscles, decreasing the calcium sensitivity all across the muscle fiber up to the sarcoplasmic reticulum, where the calcium release is decreased from the sarcoplasmic reticulum. And the inorganic phosphate may promote the precipitation of the calcium due to decreasing the ATP along with the high availability of magnesium ions in the contractile muscles. So these are the things usually promoted by inorganic phosphate, finally accelerates the fatigue. And next one is increase in the lactate or lactic acid in the contractile muscles, that further decreasing the pH. The pH may drop even up to 6.5 during the high intensity activities. The high level of lactate may promote the mishandling of the calcium in the contractile muscles. High level of H+ ion, however, compete with the troponin binding area in the troponin C, which further decreasing the affinity of calcium binding site. And further, the high level of H plus ion or protons in the cytosol of contractile muscle, decreasing the sarcoplasmic releasing of the calcium, which further decreasing the action potential propagation and facilitates or accelerates the fatigue. The next factor is ROS, reactive oxygen species. These reactive oxygen species generates as a byproduct of the increasing oxidative phosphorylative process in the cytosol as well as mitochondria of the contractile fibers, contractile muscle fibers. And these ROS may generate from the increased NADPH oxidation of the TCA cycle. And however, these increasing the oxygen molecule may escape from the mitochondria during the high intensity activity could be the reason of ROS. So these factors also promotes or accelerates the fatigue. The next factor is the temperature. The temperature, usually if it touches 40 degrees of the core temperature of the body, which accelerates the fatigue or promotes the fatigue. Essentially ICF, intracellular environment, pH, inorganic phosphate, ROS, and contractile elements or contractile proteins are temperature sensitive elements. So these elements are purely temperature sensitive. Increased temperature would minimize these activity, finally promotes the fatigue. And next factor is the failure of action potential propagation from the cell membrane into the T-tubule system promotes the fatigue. The factors which promotes the failure of action potential propagation are decreasing the perfusion, which increases the potassium accumulation in the mainly the interstitial fluids, and the acid increasing the H plus ion levels induces decreasing the calcium conductance, and high activity of the sodium potassium pump. These factors usually promotes the fatigue by decreasing the action potential propagation by disturbance of the ionic concentration across the cell membrane as well as ICF. And cell membrane itself, there is a mishandling of the sodium as well as potassium. So increase the potassium efflux is usually seen during the high activity and decreasing the sodium influx also one of the factor. Further, these two mishandling of ionic channels which promotes the fatigue or facilitate the fatigue by decreasing the propagation of the action potentials. So coming to the CNS feedback of the fatigue, the information from the contractile elements would reach to the central nervous system via 3 and 4th sensory affine fibers, which are A delta and C fibers. And also the lungs sending the information to the central nervous system via J receptors during the high activity, And finally, the buffer nerves, 9th and 10th cranial nerves, also sends the information about the chemical change of the blood to the central nervous system. So these are the input to the central nervous system about the high intensity activity or fatigue related activity. Finally, the central nervous system minimizes the voluntary drive of motor neuronal pool basis on the information received from the peripheral contractile muscles, and further it promotes the feeling of fatigueness in the central nervous system, and the person feel like to give up the exercise. It's a safety mechanism in order to prevent the over damage to the contractile elements for the longer time. And this is how the fatigue and fatigue related the factors, the finally the information reaches to the central nervous system, and further the central nervous system take the appropriate measures in order to maintain the constant homeostasis of the cells as well as body by forceful cessation of the exercise when it reaches to the threshold. Yet, the limited research is available as per central nervous system is concerned regarding fatigue related physiological manifestations. This is all about the fatigue and the factors promoting the fatigue at this cellular level or peripheral level and central nervous system. Thank you for watching.